My name's John Tanner. I'm one of the professors in the School of Psychology at the University of East London, and I teach on our undergraduate programmes and master's level programmes. My research interests are around drug use and addiction, and that's what I want to speak to you a little bit about today. We're going to look briefly at what addiction is. We're going to look at the role of the central nervous system, in particular the brain, in addiction. And then finally, I want to talk about distress. And the possibility that the best way of understanding addictions and treating them is to look at the underlying causes. To begin with, let's think for a moment about our own behaviour and perhaps the behaviour of people around us, and ask the important question, when does something that you or I do become problematic? There are lots of different types of behaviour that we study in psychology, and in particular in relation to addictions. And the pictures here just illustrate some of those. Now you can pause this slide for a moment if you're watching this with somebody and discuss whether you feel you understand when a behaviour is what we might call normal and when it becomes problematic. And interesting questions such as, who does it become problematic for? Is it problematic for the individual? For their friends or their family, for other people that they know, for people in the workplace? Or is it problematic on some level for society? Now, we like our definitions in psychology. So a first question to ask moving on is, what is addiction? Fairly generally speaking, we could argue that an addiction is any behaviour over which a person feels they have limited or little control, sometimes no control, and which is harmful. And by harmful, we mean potentially harmful to the individual, harmful to other people, harmful to the workplace, and so on. And with addiction, we tend to see a particular pattern of effects. Firstly, the frequency of the behaviour, say for example, the use of a particular drug, increases over time. We also see that there is a shift in the experience that the individual has with that behaviour. And that shift is often characterised by moving from liking the experience to a sense of needing or wanting, or often referred to as craving, the experience. And then finally, what we often see in people suffering problems of addiction is that that behaviour has become a core focus in their life. There are lots of interesting questions that arises of overlap with other possible terms in psychology, and those are things that we certainly explore when we teach this subject and when we research it. If we look at the brain and what's important in addiction, the area that is most often looked at is the striatum. This is often seen as the area of the brain that responds to what's called reward or pleasurable experiences, things that we do that make us feel good or things that we do that stop us feeling bad. So this can involve things such as eating, sexual behaviour, socialising, gaming, gambling, social media. But the other thing that the striatum does is it sends a signal to other parts of the brain to guide us towards seeking out those behaviours in the future. So when we do something pleasurable, the striatum becomes very active and we experience pleasure. But there's also a signal sent to other areas of the brain to tell us to seek out that behaviour again in the future. Now, in the area of addiction, the striatum is seen as really important, particularly when we look at drugs, because drugs can be seen to cause quite profound activation in this area. So stimulant drugs, for example, will cause a powerful activation of in the striatum, which then guides the brain to want to seek out that experience in the future. The theory here when we're looking at the brain is that drugs in particular, but also some behaviours like gambling, hijack the striatum. They hijack this reward system in the brain to stimulate it in particularly powerful ways that lay down a blueprint that make us seek out this behaviour again and again. And this is one of the most established theories within the psychology of addiction. That what we have with addiction is a cycle where if a drug causes profound activation in the striatum, it will cause future drug seeking. Let's think again about this. Is it likely that simple brain effects explain the complexity of addiction? When we think about all the different types of addiction and the different experiences that different people with that problem have. And the important question of what makes some people far more likely to suffer from addiction than others. To answer this question, we need to begin to look outside of just the simple systems that become activated during experiences of pleasure. Our own research here at UEL enlightens this question to some degree. We've done many studies over a number of years looking at different substances, such as ecstasy, cocaine, alcohol, cannabis, and smoking, or nicotine use. And one of the things that many of these studies have shown is that there are high rates of distress in people who are at the upper spectrum of using these substances. So people who use larger doses of recreational drugs, who've taken them for much longer periods of time, who combine them with other substances, seem to have far more problems with their mental health. One of the usual ways of trying to explain this relationship is to suggest that the drugs cause the problem. However, there's lots of evidence to suggest that the problems often predate drug use. So people who have profound problems that cause them distress may be individuals who then go on to use drugs in a way that is problematic and leads to addiction. Our research here at UEL, in particular with a charity called the Gordon Moody Association, has also shown this kind of relationship with gambling. So people entering treatment for their gambling problems often report very high levels of distress in the data that we have. This can include the experience of depression and suicidal thoughts. Our work has also shown that people seeking treatment have often a history of adverse events in childhood. And so this again points to the importance of distress. Distress, these negative states, are likely linked to a cycle that leads to addiction, and the addiction feeds the distress. We can summarize this by looking at a particular model where we see that a state of unhappiness, a distressing psychological state, can lead us to seek out relief in some form. That might be through the use of substances, it might be through other behaviors. If that distress is particularly severe, it means that the need, the drive to seek out those relieving experiences, such as drug use, is far more powerful. And this creates a vicious cycle, because in addition to the distress that we might naturally feel because of all kinds of events in our past and existing lives, the drug itself, or the behavior like gambling, can lead to additional distress, with effects like withdrawal, side effects, being in debt. So what we see is that with many individuals suffering from addiction, they are to some degree trapped in this negative distress addiction cycle, where negative states lead them to seeking out behaviors that cause relief, even if it's just temporary relief. Now, this can seem like quite a miserable picture, but for us as psychologists, our understanding of addiction through this lens of distress means that we have two targets for therapy and two targets for future research. We can help people by trying to tell them about the behavior itself and the harms that that might cause and how we can help them to reduce those behaviors. But we can also try to tackle the underlying root of the distress, to help people to understand that their past and how that's led them to the place that they're in. So psychology has something really powerful and important to do in helping people suffering from addiction. Thank you for listening, and I hope you've enjoyed this short talk. If you're interested in our work, do follow us And you can also get in touch with us any point if you want to find out more about our research and also about the courses that we run in psychology at the University of East London.